Hello, this is NanoDano at devdungeon.com with the next lesson in the Python cookbook series. If you haven't seen the earlier videos in the series, check those out. In this lesson, we'll explore functions. We've already seen several functions. Print, input, and type were some of the built-in Python functions we've already seen. We also saw the randint function, which generates a random integer. The randint function came from the random module, which we had to import. Let's create a new Python file in our project and call it functions. As we've seen so far, Python runs your script line by line from top to bottom. There are certain control structures, like the while loop that we saw, which will alter the execution path of a program. We also saw the if, else, and elsif, or elif, which can also make the execution skip over certain lines or jump to a certain line if conditions are met or not met. Functions are also a way of controlling the execution of a program and organizing code. Now we're going to see how to create our own functions. The special keyword in Python is def, D-E-F, which is short for define. This will allow us to define a function. Let's create a function called greet underscore user, which will, as you probably guessed, print out a greeting to the user. We type def space greet underscore user, open parentheses, close parentheses. Our first function isn't going to take any parameters, so we don't need to put anything inside the parentheses. Just like the if statement and the while statement, we want to associate a specific block of code with this function. We do this by adding a colon at the end of the line that defines the function, and then indenting the subsequent lines of code one level. When you press enter after the colon, PyCharm will automatically indent for you. Then we can add a print statement saying hello. Let's run the program. Nothing happened. That's because all we did was define the function. We are just telling Python, hey, this function exists and this is what it should do when we call it. We aren't actually calling it though. The same way print and input functions exist, we have to call them before they're executed. Let's actually call our function now. We have to call it below the definition so that by this point in execution, Python knows what that function is. To call it, you simply type the function name with the parentheses, greet underscore user. Now let's run that. That looks better. Let's add another line inside the function, print welcome. Let's put a blank line between these print statements. You can have blank lines between code within a function. What's important is the level of indentation. Let's create another function called greet user by name. This is going to take one parameter. We need the user's name in order to greet them properly, so let's add a parameter between the parentheses and call it name. Then we can say print hello plus name. Then let's call our function. Let's put a name directly inside the parentheses, inside quotation marks, and then run it. Let's modify the code slightly and put the user's name in a variable instead, and then pass the variable to the function. We could also use the input function to ask the user for their name. We could also put input directly inside the function parameters for the print statement. Functions can take multiple parameters as well. Let's modify greet user by name to take a second parameter. The second parameter will be the greeting to use, so let's call the variable greeting. Let's modify the print statement to use the custom greeting and update our call to the function. When greet user by name is called, it's first going to evaluate the parameters, so the input function will get run first, and whatever value is returned from that will get passed as the first parameter. A function in this form must have all parameters present. You cannot call greet user by name without providing both parameters. Let's take a second to clean up this code. First, I want to use some white space to separate the function definitions and the main code. You can put two blank lines between function definitions. Then, I want to add some comments to document the functions. This is called a doc string. Three quotation marks is used to open and close a multi-line comment, but you can also use them on a single line. Okay, this looks a little more organized and easier to read. I hope you will agree. You do not have to use the exact spacing I do with the blank lines, but it is important to keep the indentation the same, which is 4 spaces per level. Okay, let's get back to the functions. It is also possible to provide default arguments for functions. We can assign a default value to the greeting parameter by adding an equal sign and giving it a value, in this case, hello. We can leave our call to the function exactly the same, but we can also remove the second argument from the call. When we do this, it will use the default greeting of hello, since we did not specify a greeting to use. We could also provide a default value for the first parameter. Let's use the name user if no other name is specified. Now we have a few options when calling the function. We can call it with no arguments. It would then use the default arguments for both parameters. We can call it by passing the arguments in the order that it expects, name first, and then the greeting. This will use both of our values instead of the defaults. We can also call the function with the arguments out of order. If we put them out of order, then we have to be explicit and tell the function which argument is which. When we call it this time, we say greeting equals welcome and name equals nanodano. A little note about terminology. When you hear the term parameter, it refers to the variable in the definition of the function. When you hear the term argument, it refers to the value being passed to a function when it is called. Although, honestly, I tend to use the terms interchangeably. The last topic I want to cover with functions is return values. Our greet function performs a series of actions, like printing to the screen, but it doesn't return any value. We saw the input function earlier, which is an example of a function that does return a value. When we call input, we store the value that it returns in a variable. To demonstrate it, let's create a simple function named cube with one parameter named base number. The code for the function is pretty simple. Cubed value equals base number times base number times base number. The asterisk, or star sign, is the symbol for multiplication. So we have this variable called cubed value, but it only exists within our function. When our function is done running, all of the variables created inside the function are destroyed, so we won't be able to use that value anywhere outside the function. What we want to do is return the value. This is how you get a value back from a function. To do this, we use the return keyword and give it the value we want to return. Note that return is not a function, so it does not take parameters and does not need parentheses. You just type return space and the name of the variable or value. In this case, we don't actually want to make a decision about what to do with the value. We don't know whether we should print it out, use it in some other calculation, or what. We just want to return it back to the caller and let them decide what to do with the value. So let's call our function down below. Cube 11. Leaving it like this would really have no effect because it would calculate the value and return it, but we're not storing it anywhere or printing it out or doing anything with it. Let's store it in a variable named 11 cubed. And then print the variable. Let's run it now and make sure everything works. Yep, everything looks good. When it comes to naming your variables, I recommend using a name that describes the variable. This is sometimes called self-documenting code, where your variable names and function names clearly describe what is going on to the point where you don't need to pull out the external documentation just to understand what's happening. Using variable names like I or N or X are valid names, but if you need to go read your own code months or years down the road, you may not remember what I was supposed to represent. There's no performance hit for choosing a longer variable name, so be as descriptive as you feel you need to be. Let's commit our file to the local Git repository and push our changes to GitHub. If you notice in the project panel on the left, the functions.py file is green. This is because it is a new file that we've added that has not yet been committed to Git. Right-click on the root folder in the project and go to Git commit directory. Add a comment saying you are adding function examples, and choose commit and push. Finalize the push so your changes go to GitHub, and you are done. Now you have some more reference material for your cookbook. Creating functions is something you'll do all the time and will become second nature. But until that happens, don't be afraid to refer to your cookbook. If you have any questions about this lesson, please leave a comment. In the next lesson, we'll explore a new variable type called list. If you enjoyed this video, subscribe to the channel and visit devdungeon.com. Thanks for watching, and keep coding!